we, at the January 13th meeting, in the last meeting, the board had acted to suspend bylaw 151 and 152 to postpone the election of officers until July 2020. We had elected officers last July, and later on in tonight's meeting, there's actually a second reading of policies to permanently change the election of board officers to July. However, because Board President Michael Wendorf, his last meeting was the end of January, we need to appoint a new board president this evening. According to parliamentary procedure, the board vice president would automatically fulfill the rest of the term of the board president. However, I am currently board vice president, and I would like to have the board actually affirmatively move and support whoever they would like to be board president. So we are suspending bylaw 151 and 152, and so if anyone would like to make a motion regarding the office of president, I'll open it up.
I move that Julie Schumacher be nominated to the office of president.
Any discussion? Any other nominations?
Sorry, I just want to make just because Michael Wendorf was the school board president for so long, that's something that we haven't thought about for a while. I think it's a role that's often misunderstood by board members. Michael got it right. I remember when Dick first promoted Michael, some of us thought, oh boy, he has such a strong personality. How's that going to work with him being board president? And he did a great job, and he really grew into the role and earned everyone's respect. He was able to put his own interests aside and make sure that we all felt valued as people, even during troubled times. He took his training and had the best attendance in the long run of anyone. He understood that being board president was not a position of authority, but a position of service, more like a chairman, really. The president will put in more hours, do more paperwork, take more of the heat, and be required to maintain order, while at the same time recognizing that as school board members, we are co-equals at the table and all deserve the same treatment. That's a tightrope sometimes to walk. By co-equal, I mean that everyone has one vote and all actions are voted collectively. The board president has organizational authority, but not autonomous authority. It doesn't really matter too much who the president is, which is something we've talked about in the past. You know, maybe it's, but as long as she, in this case, is respectful of her colleagues, has their respect, is collegial, which by definition is marked by power or authority vested equally in each of a number of colleagues, and willing to put in the time and effort to adequately represent the school board in matters, in official matters, as directed by the board. Sadly, there aren't a lot in the way of perks. It's a fairly thankless job sometimes. The president is expected sometimes to wait until the end of discussions to speak, and only takes actions as directed by the board. It may not always be popular in the community, although that would be an exception this evening. Although any one of us could be president, and we've talked about rotating it so that everyone has a turn, and sometimes it's been difficult to even find someone willing to do the job, I would support Julie. I think Julie will do a fine job, and I thank you for being willing to do it. And there's no reason why you wouldn't be a respectable board president. And let's see, last thing I want to say is, pretty much just thank you.
Are there any other nominations for board president? Self-nominations? Hearing none. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, say voice your dissent. Okay, motion has passed. Thank you all. I appreciate the confidence in your vote, and I certainly will try to run our meetings and to represent the board to the best of my ability. And I also welcome any gentle reminders from those at the table. Should I miss a procedural step along the way, welcome for that feedback. Seeing that the position of vice president is now vacant, I would happily entertain a motion from someone on a nomination for vice president.
I'll nominate Rob Dar.
For a second? Any discussion? Any other nominations for vice president?
I was going to nominate Mark, but Ron's a great choice.
So there's been a motion and a second for Ron Dar to serve in the office of vice president. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Congratulations, Ron.
Yeah, I'll let you know.
I won't be at the next few meetings.
Okay, very good.
Okay. Next on our agenda is the approval of the meeting minutes from the January 13th meeting. Are there any, I'll entertain a motion for those minutes.
I move that the Board of Education approve the meeting minutes from the January 13th, 2020 meeting. As presented.
For a second. Are there any changes or edits to those minutes? Hearing none, all in favor of approving the minutes for January 13th, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? The minutes are approved. Next, approval of the agenda. Happy to entertain a motion.
Approve the agenda as presented.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Okay. The minute, the agenda is approved as presented. Next, this evening, we have a school presentation for the reproductive health curriculum presentation and a public hearing. So I would like to open this as a public hearing. Following the proposal presentation, members of the public will have the opportunity to discuss the proposed curriculum. There will be an opportunity for the board to discuss the curriculum later on in the meeting during the discussion portion of the agenda. And then on February 27th at 6 p.m., there will be a community meeting in Creekside, Room 311, for additional time for discussion. And there'll be a second public hearing and a board vote on the agenda at one of our meetings in Rochester. So with that, I will open the public hearing, and if someone from the reproductive health committee would like to come forward and give us a presentation.
Good evening. Service members of the reproductive health committee, this is the reproductive health advisory committee, is made up of faculty, students, community members, parents, and one of the charges of the committee is to review reproductive health curriculum for grades K through 12. For decades, the Dexter Community School District has incorporated reproductive health into its health and safety curriculum. Reproductive health.
Can people in the back hear?
No.
No. Do you have a microphone?
I think somehow it's all these folks here.
Reproductive health content has met grade level content expectations outlined by the Michigan Department of Education. In the past, the Michigan model for health was utilized for lesson plans and audiovisual tools. The Michigan model was last updated in 2010. Since that time, as the content of the curriculum and video resources have become outdated. Specifically, topics about LGBTQ issues are sorely lacking. At this time, as we are unaware of any plans to update the Michigan model curriculum. Over the past 2 years, the Dexter Community Schools Reproductive Health Advisory Committee has heard from school district administrators, teachers, students, and others that education about LGBTQ issues is needed. There are students in the district who identify as LGBTQ who are experiencing bullying, harassment, social exclusion, discrimination, and whose education may be hindered. Additionally, over 40% of the 7th through 12th grade student population that responded to a recent anonymous survey feel they lack information about LGBTQ issues and desire. As a result of these unmet needs, the committee has reviewed newer evidence-based reproductive health curriculums that include LGBTQ topics. We are proposing the use of the rights, respect, responsibility for 3 hours curriculum for use in grades 7 through 12. The 3 hours curriculum is a result of 30 years of research into effective sexuality education programs while respecting young people's right to the information they need to protect their health and make responsible decisions. The 3 hours content is aligned with the National Sexuality Education Standards, and the state is moving towards adopting these standards for the reproductive health curriculum. So we adopted this, basically being ahead of the curve as the state. It's recommended by Lori Beckhover, who is Michigan Department of Education HIV STD consultant. It's recommended by Mary Bino, who is the Regional School Health Coordinator for Livingston and Washtenaw Counties. Michigan Department of Ed, again, is looking at aligning curriculum to these standards, and also is recommended by the MISHCA. It is co-authored by Elizabeth Schrader, Eva Goldfarb, and Nora Gelperin, all experts in the field of sexuality education with years of professional experience. The curriculum is free and requires no additional teacher training.
The 3 hours curriculum content for grades 7 through 12 covers the following topics. While topics are repetitive over the 6 years, they are developmentally appropriate for the student's age and build upon earlier lessons. So the 3 hours curriculum content is physical, social, cognitive, and emotional changes of adolescence, anatomy and function of the reproductive system, the process of human reproduction, characteristics of friendships versus romantic relationships, non-sexual activities to show affection, characteristics of unhealthy and emotionally abusive relationships and relationship abuse, ways to leave an unhealthy or emotionally abusive relationship, and resources for help. Partners' roles and responsibilities, especially when there is a power difference between the two. Characteristics of effective communication, including during conversations about sexual activity, STDs, and consent. Setting boundaries and how to communicate them. The impact of rape, sexual assault on victims, with emphasis that it is not the fault of the victim. Resources for sexual assault survivors. Different sexual orientations, the components that determine sexual orientation. Understanding gender and gender identity. Respectful ways of communicating with or about LGBTQ individuals, decision-making models, including decisions involving pregnancy prevention and safer sex, abstinence and its role in pregnancy and STD prevention, birth control for teens, how to avoid STDs, symptoms of STDs, where to go for diagnosis and treatment, pregnancy symptoms, options for pregnancy, prenatal care, and ways to promote a healthy pregnancy. Characteristics of good parents, resources for parenting help, federal and state laws relating to minors' rights and reproductive health, technology as it pertains to sexting, child pornography, and laws related to sexting, how to determine the accuracy of information from various resources, especially online, staying safe online, LGBTQ inclusion and safety in schools, advocacy, lobbying, persuasive arguments for policy change, self-concept and body image and what influences those, how external influences and societal messages impact attitudes about bullying, sexual harassment, sexual assault, sexual abuse, incest, rape, and dating violence, and how alcohol, other substances, friends, family, media, society, and culture influence decisions about engaging in sexual behavior. As with all reproductive health content taught in school, and by law, parents have the right to review all reproductive health curriculum and opt their child out of the entire curriculum or certain lessons within the curriculum. This has always been the practice in Dexter Community Schools.
Mr. Chairman, can you clarify one thing? Mm-hmm. We all know what 3 hours mean in college. It means you meet 3 days a week for 1 hour per semester. What exactly do you mean 3 hours here?
Is that just
three hours.
So it's short hours. Rights, respect, responsibility.
Oh, you didn't say hours. I'm sorry.
And we'll have an opportunity for board questions later on during this discussion portion. Is there more to your presentation, or should we open it up to the public at this point?
That's it.
So, if there are any members of the public who wish to speak about the reproductive curriculum, now would be an opportunity. I know I received three of the green forms, and in looking at the topics that you wish to speak on of the forms that I've received, these are also deal with reproductive health. So Melanie Dever, Autumn Campbell, and Brittany Patel, you would have an option as to whether you would like to speak during the hearing portion or during the public comment portion. So to begin, Autumn Campbell, would you like to speak during the public hearing, or do you want to wait to the public comment?
No, I'll speak now.
Okay, feel free to come on.
So I brought a visual aid because I'm going to use some terms that I want to make sure all of us are familiar with. And so I brought in the terms for heterosexism, transphobia, and then something very different that maybe some people aren't familiar with, which is anti-heterosexism and anti-transphobia. So heterosexism, sometimes referred to as homophobia, is defined as the marginalization and or oppression of people who are lesbian, gay, bisexual, queer, and or asexual based on the belief that heterosexuality is the norm and the only acceptable orientation. I'm also going to be talking about transphobia. It is a fear, hatred, disbelief, or mistrust of people who are transgender and whose gender identities and or gender expressions don't conform to binary gender rules and roles. And transphobia prevents transgender and gender nonconforming people from living free from harm, and that includes harassment, bullying, physical abuse, murder, and also death by suicide. And then I want to talk to you today about being anti-heterosexist and anti-transphobic. And so that is a powerful collection of practices and policies that lead to equity between sexual orientations, attractionality, gender expression, and gender identities. So good evening, my name is Autumn Campbell. I'm a resident of Dexter Village. And as you review the updated and inclusive sex ed curriculum, and listen to community members voice their support and concerns regarding the content, I am encouraging you not to be deceived by the false equivalences you will hear regarding the LGBTQIA community. You may hear people falsely equate a child's discomfort to being introduced to inclusive curriculum with the lived experiences of oppression, neglect, and erasure that our LGBT students endure every day. You may hear people state that they, quote, support LGBTQ students, but, and they will go on. I want to be clear. You cannot both support LGBTQ students and want a public school district to discriminate against them. This is not merely a matter of disagreement. We do not get to disagree on a child's humanity. A social justice activist once stated, "We can disagree and still love each other unless your disagreement is rooted in my oppression and denial of my humanity and my right to exist." No one can claim to be not heterosexist or not transphobic. You are either anti-heterosexist and anti-transphobic, or you are heterosexist and transphobic. You are either actively working to dismantle bigotry and oppression, or you are supporting it. We do not get to claim neutrality. Our silence and action and maintenance of the status quo are complicity. You can also not claim yourself to be an ally of the LGBTQ community. Allyship is a relationship that you must earn through our activism. Allies create and support policy and culture changes, and they engage in personal and interpersonal advocacy. It is not a title that we once earned and for our forever members. Allyship requires us to be vigilant, It requires that we act as co-conspirators with the communities we say we support. I'm asking you to be my co-conspirator in education justice. I'm asking you to be a true ally of the LGBTQ community. I am expecting you to be anti-heterosexist and anti-transphobic. I'm asking you to use your power to dismantle the oppression and injustice in your schools. These are your students. Their health and well-being are in your hands. And I ask you to hold them with great care. Thank you.
Next, Melanie Dever. So I'm one of the teachers at Mill Creek and one of the founders and staff members who runs Mill Creek's Open Space Group. It is a club for LGBTQ youth and their allies. All of our kids need to feel safe if we want them to learn and grow. And ultimately, as the adults in their lives, that is our mission, is to help them learn and grow. And they need to feel like they belong. And they need to see themselves in their curriculum. They need to see the relevance of what we teach to their lives. As a math teacher, I get the question all the time, when are we ever going to use this? I'm imagining you guys don't get that question quite so often. But one thing that we know is that suicide rates among our LGBTQ youth are many times higher than their peers. And helping our students see themselves and feel a sense of belonging truly can save lives. That's not an exaggeration. There are many teachers here, and I'm one of them, who have experienced firsthand the devastation of losing students to suicide. It is unimaginable. We would be remiss if we don't do everything we can to prevent that from happening again. We need to take this opportunity to build that sense of safety and belonging among our most at-risk students. Rob Grams put it well. He said, "Safe schools save lives." And this curriculum makes our schools safe.
Thank you. Brittany Patel.
Hi, my name is Brittany Patel. I currently reside in Ann Arbor, but I grew up in Dexter. I was born here, I went to school here, K through 12. I recognize a lot of faces in the audience. I guess I felt compelled to come out to provide a little historical perspective about the status of reproductive health education in Dexter, because I went through it. And I'm a graduate of 2008, was when I graduated, so now it's been over a decade later. And I want you to know that we needed this new proposed curriculum then. We really did. It was not mentioned in any of my health education classes. Things like sexual orientation, gender identity, gender expression, seeing different examples of types of relationships other than cisgender and heterosexual, that was not shown, and really to our detriment. There were a lot of epithets that went around, name-calling that I saw, that I may have participated in, friendships that unfortunately were interrupted by a lot of ignorance around not knowing what was going on as people were learning more about themselves and discovering their identities, and those friendships being alienated because nobody was talking about it. And it was really sad to see them. And then I got to live out kind of the experience of seeing those friendships erode and seeing the mental health consequences that came with that, because they are very real. And I find myself getting emotional thinking about it. And when I think about how that could be different years later, how we could really make a difference now, because we needed it then, we need it now. And I think the Reproductive Health Education Committee has done a remarkable job of being thorough in their analysis about where the gaps are in our current health education and looking at other kinds of curriculum like 3Rs to fill those gaps, which would meet the needs of young people in our community and really have brought those voices to the forefront. I was very moved at the previous board meeting when they showed how much kids in this community, in this district, are hungering for that information because they're not getting it yet. So there's a great opportunity here to fill that need, to enact real change for the kids in this district. So as an alumna, I hope that we can change this. I hope that you listen to the voices of youth in this community. And yeah, I look forward to you changing that curriculum and really kind of getting on board with the general cultural shift that has been taking place in Dexter. It's not quite the bigoted place that it was when I was here. I go down these halls and I see rainbow flags. I participated in a mental health awareness day at the middle school that gave me a lot of hope that things are changing. So this is one more thing in that cultural shift. So, as I say, I look forward to the day when that is going to change. I fully support the new proposed curriculum, and thank you very much for the opportunity to speak.
Tom Moore, Moyer.
I'm sorry.
Hi. My kids went to Dexter. I am living in Dexter for 20 years. I'm going to take the opposite position here. I noticed in reading Mr. Graham's letter of support, he stated that the need for LGBTQ plus awareness curriculum. It appears to me, however, that the school district has gone too far in this issue. And if you really look at some of the materials that were put together, some of the PowerPoint presentation, they've actually made this issue the centerpiece of the proposed reproductive curriculum. And the thing that I have the greatest concern about is the people who put together the summary plan curriculum are actually advocates. How can you be an advocate and provide a balanced view of issues like this? So for example, there's use of the word of assigned anatomy. Well, I don't think that's necessarily an accepted, universally accepted belief of parents and or the scientific community at this point in time. There's no meaningful discussion of what the primary role of sexuality is, which is to have children. That's the primary role of the sexual function. In fact, under one of the reproduction basic slides, the only real emphasis is actually how to avoid having children. So there's not any meaningful discussion of the power and wisdom of abstinence or accountability in sexual activity. There's no discussion about the virtues and benefits of chastity and the dignity of the human person. There's also a reference in the prior proposal presentation there's a reference to the programs provided by medical providers, parents, schools, and other professions. And it's not clear to me it's not clear to me what level of input the parents have actually had. I note that the surveys were sent to students, but were surveys sent to parents? I mean, don't the parents have a say in this? Aren't the parents primarily responsible for raising their children and engendering good values in them? They're the legal guardians of their children. And many times, parents have greater wisdom than children, 7th and 8th and 9th graders. And my concern is, when did the schools presume to take over this responsibility? Isn't this a responsibility of parents? And then I guess my final point here is I see no input or even referencing here faith-based organizations. How come faith-based organizations, local churches in the community, did not weigh in on this issue? They have a strong voice in this. And are we going to end up having a situation 10 years from now where we're talking about kids who practice their faith, like my kids did at the Dexter schools, and who were unmercifully bullied, and the schools never did a thing about it? Never did a thing about it. Okay? And so why would we not just have a more comprehensive program about bullying? Okay? This is just one portion of this. It's by your own statistics, 7% of the students identify as having same-sex attraction. What about the other 93%? So, that's my two cents.
Thank you. Deacon Reverend Dave Lawrence.
Hi, my name is Deacon Dave Lawrence. I'm a minister of the gospel. I have four children that went through public schools here at in different times, and we currently have one at Dexter. And I've taught 41 years, retired from public schools. I had tenure in three different districts in the state of Michigan. So I have kind of a wide, reflection of public school experience. Most of mine have been in public schools. And one of the things that I unequivocally support, non-discrimination in any form. I minister at the county jail, Washtenaw County Jail, and I've done it for years and years and years. And I don't do that because I hate people, or the people that we go to, our team hates people. We love to minister to people. But what I see in this, very, very concerned about, and the reason it is I think it's an affront to every parent here and every adult here, because much of the curriculum, not all of it, but much of it basically says that we can't trust our children, we can't trust our parents to raise our children, in a way, abstinence-based, I'm just mentioning it, that, they have the maturity to say, we have to take that responsibility over. They're going to have sex, so what we're going to do is we're just going to try to prevent that. And I think that's really an affront to have, to be able to send that message to our kids. I think that there's no question we should never have any kind of, discrimination in any sort of way. And I see that all the time in my work. And that absolutely can't happen. But I don't think this is the way that we want to go. I think our role as parents, needs to be that sacred role. And I know you do have that part in there that, there's an opt-out plan. But I think to really to push that on, to say this is going to be the center of our curriculum, I think we need to be about the work of educating our children. And I think that this is really important to really understand here. I don't think we can take that from parents, that right to be able to raise their children in the way that they want to, okay? And I know that's what we have done. And I'd like to read just for a minute, because I think it's really a dangerous place. It's a very dangerous place for us to live, and I see this in my work in the jail, to when we define what we want to be. I think that's defined, and I know where I'm coming from is, I think it's defined in the first chapter of Genesis, all right? Who we're fighting. I think it's a very dangerous place to be when we attempt to define our biology by what we want instead of our creator. Here's what, from John Hopkins University and an esteemed psychiatrist. His name is Dr. Paul McHugh. He was the head of psychiatry at John Hopkins. It's one of the, the most esteemed hospitals in the country. He's retired, but he's currently a distinguished service professor of psychiatry. And he says this, transgenderism is a mental disorder that merits treatment, that sex change is biologically impossible, that people who promote sexual reassignment surgery are collaborating and promoting a mental disorder. McHugh, author of 6 books, has at least 125 peer-reviewed medical articles, made comments on this, that the transgender surgery is not the solution for people who suffer a disorder of assumption. The notion that their maleness or females is different than what nature has assigned to them biologically. Okay, and then he talks about that study's been mentioned before, that the study that the suicide rates, they are 20% 20 times higher, and that's reported by Vanderbilt University and London's Portman Clinic of children who expressed transgender feelings, but from whom over time 70-80% of their spontaneous lost those feelings. Okay, and then finally I just want to say this. He says this, the transgender person disorder, says Dr. McHugh, is a person's assumption that they are different than the physical reality of their body. Their maleness or femaleness is assigned by nature. It is a disorder similar to dangerously thin person suffering from anorexia who looks in the mirror and thinks they're overweight, said McHugh. And so I strongly, you know, oppose this curriculum based on what we see and what's written here. What's written here. Thank you.
Thank you. Janet Lawrence?
Here we have four children that have been in the district, one currently in eighth grade. And, I was looking at it from a slightly different perspective. I wanted to see what was going on for the seventh and eighth grade curriculum. And I actually went to Advocates for Youth, to their website, pulled up some lesson plans, looked through it, and just, I'm appalled. It's just totally, totally inappropriate age-wise. And it also, the information that's given isn't even necessarily accurate. For instance, it seems like, just looking at the birth control basics, looking at that one, there seems like their go-to birth control choices, condoms. And they say, oh, they have 98% effectiveness, failure rate at preventing pregnancy. That's only if they are consistently and correctly used. And I don't know any of them that has a 14-year-old that ever follows directions correctly and consistently. If you ask a 14-year-old to utilize this method of birth control, you're going to end up with 14% failure rate or more. And the reason I bring that up is I went and looked at who these authors were, and the names were mentioned. Dr. Schrader was previously a vice president of training at Planned Parenthood in New York City. And Nora Delperin was also a Planned Parenthood in New Jersey. So they've been very much about teaching sex education in many different places. And I just want to point out that the association with Planned Parenthood is not something that I consider to be a positive thing. Particularly, Planned Parenthood's business model is to get into the schools, talk to the kids about how to have safe sex, knowing that the methods that they propose are going to fail, kids are going to get pregnant, and now they've got their increased revenue from abortions. And that has been testified in court by Abby Johnson, who's a former Planned Parenthood director. This is something that they do all over the place, get into the schools, try to get kids to be sexually active, and then just when they have their methods failed, abortion is just listed as, yep, just one other option, no sense of discussing about any kind of morality of ending another person's life because they're inconvenient. So I just because of who the authors are and where it's coming from and what I'm seeing here at the 7th and 8th grade, I did not look at the high school stuff because I'm in a high school right now, but I find it totally inappropriate. Thank you.
Jim Berlucci.
I have a big mouth, so I think you can hear me. Can everyone hear me okay? As you can see, you suspect that I'm the father of a kindergartner. My Judy and I are members of the residents in Dex Group. We are parents of children who are former students. And let me clarify this. This group has the decision-making power with regard to this curriculum. Is that the case? So this board, these individuals, had the power. That's why I want to address you, because you're the ones who have the proper decision-making power. So our children were former students. Now, I'm a former professional in the Iowa school system, both at Forsyth and here on a number of years ago. I first of all want to applaud the determination to eradicate bullying, harassment, physical or verbal assault on any student for any reason. Is there anyone who would disagree with that? That's one thing we have completely in common. And I find it completely despicable that any child would be harassed, bullied, or picked upon because they're different. And I want to quote from Mr. Graham's letter here, which I thought was well put. He said, someone once said that as humans, we like to put things in boxes. When something doesn't fit in our box, we perceive it as dangerous, and our fight or flight response is activated. We lash out physically or verbally at the perceived danger. He talks further about hostile actions, derogatory comments, and so on and so forth. So I would like to speak as a parent that at least three of our children were recipients of harassment when they were in the Dexter schools. It was not because of their sexual orientation. For one, it was because of the clothes she wore. For another, it was because she was too pretty and skilled and popular. For another, it was because of her physical appearance. My point is this. There are multiple reasons why children are harassed, none of which are acceptable. I think we all agree upon that. And I strongly object to the singling out of one particular activity or behavior or identity as the basis for a burgeoning curriculum which has in effect an entirely different agenda. The agenda here is not to stop bullying, because if that's the agenda, there should be a curriculum that's thoroughgoing and effective with all kinds of punitive dimensions if there's violation. That's the core of the issue. We should be teaching our children virtues. We should be teaching them tolerance. We should be teaching them charity and respect. And when those things are violated, they should be dealt with. I think everyone is in agreement with that. That's the core of the issue. My objection, number one objection, is that you are delimiting and diminishing the multitude of reasons why children are harassed by focusing on one. It's a global issue, it's a deep issue, it needs to be effectively responded to globally and deep, not with the designation of a particular behavior or sense of identity. So it's a deeper, broader problem, and I believe that it's a disservice to any and the many reasons that children receive adverse treatment. Just focus on one, and I believe that the focus on one is not because that's the primary concern, but rather there's another agenda. And I'd like to point to the other agenda. The group that has sponsored this curriculum is called Advocates for You. It's a highly subsidized nonprofit based in Washington, D.C. It's an advocacy group. It's a pro-abortion advocacy group. It's a pro-transgender advocacy group. It's a pro-sexual activity advocacy group. So I think we need to be in very good contact with the actual source of this curriculum. And I'm wondering if the board members have in fact researched this advocacy group as well as the content of the curriculum. Yes, exactly.
We don't. We won't be responding during the public hearing.
Well, I'd like an answer to that, because I think that certainly is your duty as the governing body. So this group presents itself as young, powerful, and, quote, taking over. Young, powerful, and taking over. They boldly advocate changes in the cultural and political environment. They are professionals working to implement evidence and rights-based sexual health strategies and to engage young people and partners in the work. One of their programs is called Abortion Out Loud. Formerly the 1 in 3 campaign harnesses the power of storytelling, grassroots organizing, leadership development, and policy advocacy to end abortion stigma and to strengthen support for young people's access to abortion. As I have shared my story around the country, more often than not, other people offer up theirs in response. The result is a bond stronger than, note this, the anti-choice rhetoric. Could someone possibly render that as a pro-choice life position that's rational? No. If you have a pro-life position that's rational, what are you? You're an anti-choice rhetorician. This is an advocacy group with a strong agenda, and the Dexter Schools is considering adopting this radical agenda for the indoctrination of the children of Dexter. 99% of parents have no idea of what this is about. This is a stealth kind of operation. I'm not accusing anyone of, and I'm not accusing Ford of bringing about something stealth, but I think there's a great amount of ignorance with this. I also want to point out one other thing. Our first presentation here tonight basically juxtaposed anyone who had any disagreement with this agenda and their perspective as someone who is an intolerant bigot. I find that utterly objectionable. These things should be debated on the basis of rationality, on respect for people's actual opinions and positions. And interestingly, that position marginalized anyone who disagrees. So if we set up the argument such that if you disagree with this, you are automatically stigmatized, which is exactly doing exactly what it's claiming not to do. So those are my reflections. Many more, but I would certainly encourage people here to do your research and to find out what the actual arguments are, what the positions are, and have a rational, reasoned debate. All of us agree, bullying, harassment, any kind of disrespect for students should be absolutely intolerable.
Taxpayers reject the proposed revision to the reproductive health curriculum. This comprehensive sex education emphasizes risk reduction techniques instead of using character-based education that provides children with skills and tools to avoid risks altogether. Most parents oppose this approach, which is replete with controversial topics such as sexual pleasure, orientation, sexual dysphoria, abortion, contraceptives, other drugs, and medical procedures that carry grave health and moral risks. And by the way, the one lesson they didn't show us a sample of, it's on sexual pleasure. I'm just wondering if that's going to be a primer in pornography. These lesson plans promote behaviors which jeopardize the health and well-being of children, promote teenage pregnancies, transmission of venereal diseases, and other violence against women. Sexual dysphoria needs competent, delicate, professional treatment, which the parent or guardian should seek outside the school. The school should not pretend the student's delusion should be discussed with the rest of the student body and presented as an immutable characteristic of that student. If a student had a drug problem, the school would not be praising that student for that weakness before the other students. And there are only two sexes. Strong feelings, wishful thinking, drugs, or mutilating and sterilizing surgery, or political pandering is not able to change anyone's sex. Men read in a different part of the brain than women do. Every cell in a student's body proclaims it's sex, either XX or XY. Children are fearfully and wonderfully created as either a boy or a girl. Is the RHC supposed to be factual or medically accurate? These lessons are not. Homosexual acts are learned behavior. The orientation is also not immutable. Many change their orientation with time. And I gave you a link. You can watch the interview with someone that this happened to. A child cannot make decisions about such seriously harmful behaviors, and no child should be encouraged by the school through these lessons to engage in homosexual activity. Homosexual acts lead to great emotional and bodily harm. The union is not the marital act and leaves the person caught in the prison of self. Why would the school want to encourage such dangerous and harmful behavior? It shows a lack of compassion and charity for those struggling with these feelings. There are also medical inaccuracies in the information presented on birth control. Only abstinence from sexual activity prevents pregnancy and disease transmission 100% of the time. Condoms have natural voids from the manufacture of the material, which are many times larger than that of the HIV virus. The birth control pill, besides increasing the risk of stroke, blood clots, and cancer, the World Health Organization classifies the pill as a class 1 carcinogen, does not even prevent ovulation all the time. A manager of 3 abortion mills in Dallas, Texas, Darrell Everett, used this fact to sell more abortions, even 3 or more to each girl, to teen girls. Using birth control only delays pregnancy a short time, especially with great promiscuity. Learning to put a condom on a banana or on a model is totally inappropriate for the classroom. That is immodest and an invasion of the child's privacy. These lessons promote grooming of children, not only in those classes, but also of the whole school community for child sex abuse, violence against girls, and even leading to abortion and sex trafficking. Children cannot decide these things since the decision-making part of the brain is not fully developed until the early 20s, as seen on brain scans and known by car insurance company accidents statistics. Acts of sexual perversion and birth control use are not helpful. In many cases, adults take advantage of and groom children for sexual activity as a result of this kind of class. The root cause of bullying is not even addressed in these lessons. Bullying is a fact of any school. If children spend many hours of the day with their peers, someone will become aggressive with a fellow student or students. Maybe it begins in daycare, or even at 10 months, some babies bite the other babies. This revision strongly places the blame for bullying on the fact that some children who are suffering from sexual dysphoria or homosexual orientation do not find some of their fellow students willing to play along with their fantasies. Mutual respect and kindness are a two-way street. The school has traditional means to keep it under control by detention, etc. So this revision should be rejected. The UN General Assembly rejected comprehensive sex education in November 2017. Dexter Community Schools should do likewise for the health and happiness of our community. Truth is often hard to accept, but with true charity, the Dexter community can help these students to face the reality about themselves with gentleness and respect.
Thank you.
I don't see anyone else, I don't have forms from anyone else related to this particular topic, but if anyone else would like to speak as part of the public hearing, you're welcome to. I would just ask if you would fill out the green form, that way we know who's speaking and we have contact information if you wanted us to follow up with you. Is there anyone else that would like to speak during this public hearing?
You haven't filled out a form yet.
And then fill it out afterwards.
Okay. Thank you. All right. Well.
So you wanted to speak?
Yeah, I do. A lot of emotions here I'm feeling. I'm the principal of the middle school, and I am totally coming at it from a kid's perspective on what I see every day. There's a lot of emotions in this room. I'm here to talk to you about what it's like to be a kid who identifies in the LGBTQ community. I have kids in the building. First of all, any curriculum. Yes, we have an anti-bullying committee, and yes, we really value that, and we're working on that. The arguments, we shouldn't address the LGBT because it's a really small percentage, that kind of resonates with me. We have 7%, I don't know if my number is, children of color. Does that mean we don't address that? We need to address that. We need to address the LGBT movement. I have kids who work with our counselors that ideally we would love parents to have conversations, your value system, what you believe in, what your religion may believe in. That's part of educating a child. Not every kid has that. We have some kids that if they come out, they identify as LGBT. There's nothing mentally wrong with them. I'm here to tell you that. They identify that. If they come out with their parents, some of them will be beaten up. The violence in the LGBT community is huge. And as a principal, not to address this in their community, we are putting kids at risk.
Does that happen?
Yes, yes.
Has that been reported?
She's got the floor.
Yeah, we want to make sure that the person who's speaking is allowed to be so
honored. Yeah, things happen.
So this is very passionate. This is something we believe in. The curriculum that Crystal teaches in our building is abstinence-based. Yes, we believe in that. We don't talk about abortion. We are about letting LGBT community kids identify and find help, because not every family offers that for them, and it's very unsafe in some situations. That doesn't negate the heterosexual population, that they have the right information when it comes to sex-based education. Those are, I don't know if I have the words right. I'm sorry, I'm just really emotionally attached to this. But we need to do what's right by kids. Yes, as a family and your churches, go ahead and have those value systems with your family, but know that there are kids that are getting hurt, that are unsafe, and it is our duty as educators and as a community to make kids feel that they belong. There's nothing wrong with you. There is nothing wrong with you. Thank you.
So I will after I did not plan to speak tonight. I just got done training on skis, so I'm here to support the project here. This is a really important issue in this community, and these are real kids. These are kids who are human beings, and every single one of the kids in our school, I teach at the middle school, my name is Cheryl Darnton. Every single one of the kids who is identifying as LGBTQ at Mill Creek feels the negation of who they are because they don't appear in the curriculum. And we are constantly looking for literature that includes kids who have Hispanic background, kids who have African American background, kids who have other backgrounds. We're always trying to include in our curriculum kids who have real stories. There's no kid in this school who would choose to be gay. There is no kid in this school who would choose to not feel like they are actually embodying the body they were born into because they have a different feeling about who they really are. It differs from the genitals that they were born with. Kids don't choose that. That's not an easy life. That's a very hard life, and we make it harder for kids when we don't support them in the curriculum and help their peers understand that there are lots of different ways to be normal. These kids aren't freaks. These kids are not mentally ill. These are just real kids who deserve a chance to feel whole, and we have the opportunity to help them feel whole in this community.
I just wanted to share a story from the bus that my students went through, and it was so horrible. There was a girl that came out as identifying as a boy, and my kids came home confused about it. And I was like, okay, let's talk about it. And they told me the things that were said to them. And I just couldn't, they didn't understand. And we have to be there for these kids. We really do. You can say that your kid was bullied, and my kid's been bullied too. I get it. But the suicide rates don't lie. And this gender, they just don't lie. Mm-hmm. These kids are going through more than what other students are going through. Mm-hmm. And that does not negate what those other students are going through. We can try to be there for all of their students. Like you said, I know that you're trying to be there for bullying and everything else, and everybody's trying to be on top of all of that. But this, this needs attention, and it's getting glossed over. And I don't want the school to teach morality to my child. If I want to take my child to church, and I want to have that part of our household, then that's my choice to do. I don't want that being taught to my kids. If I want to teach them those things, then I will teach them that at home. But these are facts. These are just facts. And the more education that kids have, you can either say to them, you know, that that's not what we believe at this house if they do learn it, or you can choose not to. But to have the facts so that they aren't calling these kids names and making them feel so horrible about themselves, that's what we need. We need more education so that that doesn't happen.
I'd just like to ask, my tinnitus was acting up, Mr. Teddy. 3 hours, I took it to being 3 hours. What exactly is the class structure on this? Is it one?
Our opportunity for discussion will come later in the meeting.
I would like to have that answered before people leave the hall.
And I was going to turn it back over.
Thank you, Cheryl.
I was going to also turn it back over to Mr. Teddy to respond to any of the questions or comments that we have.
Just a few things, you know, to address shortly here. First of all, the structure between all the lessons, 7th through 12th, because I believe there's 49 across the grade levels. Any health educator knows that we don't have 49 days to teach reproductive health. So there's the curriculum actually has some recommendations. Okay, is it based on time, guys, that you have available to teach your curriculum? Okay, is what those kind of not more important, guys, not a good way to put it, okay, but it's recommendations for lessons to include. So it really is, it's up to the teacher, guys, to decide, because they're not going to have 2 months, guys, to teach this curriculum, okay, is what lessons to teach. That kind of ties in with the point that I wanted to touch on. When Crystal read through those lists of topics in the beginning of our presentation, those were all the different lessons, the different topics that are taught in this curriculum. LGBTQ issues are not the centerpiece of this issue or of this curriculum. It is, I believe, 6 lessons out of 49 that include LGBTQ issues. There's many more topics that this includes. That's why we wanted to make sure that we realize that this is a comprehensive curriculum. It does talk about abstinence. It does address contraception. It does address abuse, consent, healthy relationships, encouraging communication, about sexual boundaries. This is not meant to replace the parent at home. Unfortunately, there are probably a greater percentage, at least in my experience, as teaching health education is for 15 years, there's a greater percentage of students, where they do not get the birds and the bees. They do not get the talk, with parents, the education from parents, like many people assume they do, and like they should. The purpose of health education, of education in general, is to provide as much information as to our young adults so they are well-informed and they are armed with the knowledge to make the best decision possible. This addresses some knowledge that isn't being delivered to our students. And I think that's important to realize, with this contraception. No, it's not 100% successful, other than abstinence. But some kids choose to be active. If we don't educate them about all of the different options that they have to keep themselves safe, we are doing them a disservice. That's part of this curriculum. If we don't educate them about how to have a conversation with your partner, is about boundaries, is about consent. Now, we are doing them a disservice. Now, if we don't have conversations with them, educate them about healthy relationships, we are doing them a disservice. All of that is part of this curriculum. And just want to make sure, because we realize this isn't just an LGBTQ curriculum. It is imperative, guys, that the LGBT community is addressed, because right now, with all the bullying programs that we have in our schools, guys, this is a demographic of students that we are leaving out. And while we all agree, everyone has said this, is that no one should be discriminated for any reason. We are purposely right now, maybe not purposely, but indirectly, we are leaving out this group of students. And regardless of whether it's 7% that's in our school, 20%, one kid, it's our duty, in my opinion, to make sure that we address those inequities. Thank you.
Thank you. At this time, I will now close the reproductive health hearing, and we will move on with our agenda. If anyone wants to read this, you're welcome to. If you'd like to stay for the remainder of the meeting or whatever portion, you're also welcome. Superintendent update.
We started today moving our offices officially over to Bates for approval. My office, human resources, and nutrition, and goals to be over there at the end of the month. I'm moving up to be closer to the
Defensive lineman Will Heininger just presented his students on empathy
and supporting others in mental health, and that was like a cool opportunity for those students. Wiley held their annual STEAM night celebrating their main core classes, which include science, technology, engineering, art, and science. And this was worked by National Honor Society students. Dexter's National Honor Society has started a campaign for the committee Sprout Life, which is a cancer support group. And members are asking for local businesses to financially donate to support this cause, as well as asking community members to contribute activities to run events such as activities like a bounce house. Relating to NHS, juniors who will be inducted this coming year received letters on Friday informing them that they qualified, and the GPA for this qualification moved from 3.5 to 3.8 this year. Finally, the largest event occurring in distance in the district at the moment is the production of Fiddler on the Roof, and this weekend was opening weekend, and this weekend there will be 3 more shows, 7 p.m. on Friday, 7 p.m. on Saturday, and 2 p.m. on Sunday.
Now is our opportunity, our first public comment opportunity. Typically the hearing we have is atypical, so this next opportunity is the first of 2 public comment periods. If any member wishes to speak, if you would fill out the green form in the back of the room and then bring it up to the table. There's a 5-minute individual time limit for a total of 30 minutes. We'll be allowing for comments. If more than 6 individuals wish to speak, the 30 minutes will be divided equally among the speakers. And Hope, could you keep track of the time, and then you'll get a 30-second notice towards the end of the time. And before speaking, I do have your names, and I can introduce you, but if you also mention your affiliation with the district. So the first, is there anyone else that wishes to speak at this time? I've got 2 forms. Okay. Melissa Gerharder.
I've been a member of the community for 14 years, and I have 3 perfectly imperfect biracial kids. And in 7th grade, 6th grade, and 2nd grade. And I'll be honest, I hesitated coming tonight because I didn't want it to feel like I was piling on as a result of all the local media that's been happening in the community. But then I thought about it, and I just wanted to be vocal and let you guys know that this is happening in our community. It's happening in our schools, and it's a problem. And I also wanted to point out I'm totally confident in the leadership at Mill Creek, so I know that they have this. But I just want to challenge the community, and I want to challenge the district to quote Jamie, to roll up your sleeves and let's figure this out, because it's a problem. And I also wanted to use the exact words that my son described. He called because I want to create some emotion out of you. And he was told by some peers to call him master, or that he needed to call his peers master. He needed to go back to the cotton fields. And then if he sat in a classroom, that they wouldn't be able to see him. And this is happening in the bathrooms, it's happening in the hallways, it's happening in the lunchrooms, and it's happening in the classrooms, in our schools, in our community. And I challenge the community and the district as a whole, because the community, or the district and the schools is an anchor, pun intended, of the community. And we do need to do something about it. And I don't know what that it yet is. I think that's something really hard to get our hands around, but I want to be part of the solution. And I do think it's a huge, again, dreadnought to turn, but it's a huge ship to turn. But I think we need to start pushing.
Thank you. Gurjeet Sandhu? Did I pronounce?
It's Gurjeet.
Gurjeet. Thank you.
Thank you for the opportunity to share some of our experiences. So I'm also a parent in the Dexter school system. I'm a 5th grader and 7th grader. And I have one perfect child and 1 imperfect child. One whose name is well known amongst educators, but he's amazing. So I come to speak to as a parent, and I also want to create a little bit of emotion around this as well. So my kids are racialized, and they are, they've experienced things like the gorilla emojis and turbans and being called a monkey, and I could go on. And when my son responds and says, "My mom's a doctor," and the children respond back and say, "I don't care, she's still an Indian," I want you to feel that. These are seventh graders, and so they're bringing this awareness into the schools and subjecting our children to it and their friends to it. And their friends say to my son in particular, "Don't say anything, just don't say anything." And we talk about race in our home, we talk about anti-racism, we talk about standing up for everybody who's being put down. And my son says, "If I don't say anything, who will?" I mean, he's a pretty bright kid to be able to say that. And so he's my height, he's 12, you know, he's athletic build. So I don't worry so much about him, you know. I've been there, he'll be okay. But I worry about the little kid. I worry about the shy girl. I worry about the ones who can't go home and tell their parents, the ones who don't talk about racism at home. Those are the kids I'm worried about. And I've had amazing conversations with Jamie and the leadership and Chris, I've corresponded, and I know they have my back. And they're moving on this, and I too want to be a part of the solution. And, you know, one of the brilliant things that Chris said in his, what all the superintendents said was, this is, I know this stuff. I mean, what I say now is not meant to, in any way, to show how smart I am, but I'm a teacher. I've taught in elementary schools. I have my master's. I have my PhD in education. I teach at the, you know, University of Michigan. I know this stuff. And when Chris says, this is important for communities that are predominantly white. This is important for schools that are predominantly white. I want you to hear that. Your children, your peers are going to go out to colleges that are diverse. They're going to work in workplaces that are diverse. They're going to be employed. They're going to be teaching in very diverse contexts. They need the tools to be successful. They need those strategies to be successful. And when we say things like, "Oh, it's February," that's insufficient. It's insufficient to talk about racism in February. We need to build this into what we do on a daily basis. When kids say things or hear things, they need to have tools to speak out. One of my son's teachers asked the students, "How many of you have heard this is going on or know this is going on?" And a number of hands go up, and my son came home and said, "I was surprised at the number of kids who know this is going on. I didn't think they could hear this." When those kids put up their hands, and then they're asked, "Why didn't you say anything?" And there's no answer. I wonder, is it because they don't have tools? They don't want to be targeted? You know, maybe they don't know who to tell? They don't know that they can go to Wisconsin. She has their back. When she says, "I'm going to roll up my sleeve," trust me, I believe her. I was like, okay, I'm going to follow you. So they need to have those strategies, they need tools, and they need to know this is an everyday, ongoing thing that we're going to deal with this. So I challenge the school district that you really said the words, now I want the action. And I want to, none of us has extra time. You're all very busy individuals, but I want to commit to being part of the solution. I want to be part of the strategy. I want to be on your team, so let me know how I can help.
Thank you. Is there anyone else that would like to speak at this time? Okay. Seeing none, we'll move on with our agenda. Next, we come to the consent agenda. There are three consent items.
After you
entertain the motion.
I make a motion that we approve the consent agenda with one additional thought for the seventh grade or best wishes for the question.
There's been a motion and a second. Any other comments?
I made the motion and I just said that I'd like to add to the fund of very best wishes.
I'm mistaken, it's our consent agenda, so we don't make comments. If no one wanted to pull an item, then we'll just proceed with the vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Okay. The consent agenda is approved as presented. Next, we come to our action items. The first item of our action items is to disband the ad hoc athletic committee. At the January 13, 2020 meeting, the board acted to implement the athletic restructuring proposal. Because the committee's charge has now been fulfilled, it's appropriate for the board to disband the ad hoc athletic committee.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Any comments? Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion is passed. Next on our agenda is a group of policies for second reading. These policies were brought to the board at our last meeting. All policies go through two public readings, so this, we are now in the second reading. Next, we have a group of policies in our packet for first reading. And these policies have to do with drug-free workplace, leaves of absence, curriculum development, employment of professional staff and substitutes, schools of choice options, attendance, student suicide, new construction, emergency operations plan, and food services. You can walk through those individually. Does anyone have?
I have one question on the first policy on the drug-free workplace. Why is it only, one can talk about administrators, based on the administrator shall be subject to disciplinary action? I guess I don't understand why it's restricted to that.
I think 140 is.
More policies for everybody else, that's fine.
Yeah, I think.
I just want to sure it's restricted to that.
I'm sorry, so I understood the question, and what was the answer, though?
I gotta look it up, but I think 140s are only administrative policies for administrators. I think this is already in the rest of the policies.
I know that we were.
The point is we're consistent across the board, and I'm quite content.
Are there any questions or comments on any other policies in this batch? Hearing none, happy to entertain a motion. Someone like to make that motion?
I'll move the Board of Education approve the attached policies, all of them listed there for first reading as presented.
Okay, there's been a motion and a second. Any other discussion? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? The group of policies are approved for first reading, and they'll come back in our next board meeting for second and final reading. Next on our agenda is a conservation easement for the Twin Turks. As part of the Dexter High School Twin Turk construction, Dexter Schools mitigated a wetland and required with the permit is a conservation easement from EGLE, which is formerly known as MDEQ, for access to the wetland for inspection. There is a proposed conservation easement. This was discussed at the last Board of Education meeting and is presented tonight for action. I'm happy to entertain a motion from someone.
I believe we've already committed to this, and so I'm happy to move this to the Board of Education authorized the superintendent to sign the attached conservation easement for the Twin Turks wetland mitigation.
Two seconds. Any discussion? Questions? Okay, hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And motion is passed. Next, we come to the discussion portion of our meeting. The first, it has to do with the board vacancy. So there were, based on a number of questions that different board members and the superintendent's office has received, we've added a board candidate Q&A night on Wednesday, this Wednesday, February 12th, at 6 to 7 p.m. At the Creekside Media Center, same place we are here. So if anyone is interested in finding more about that, you're welcome to come. We will be doing interviews for the applicants. The deadline to apply is February 19th. And then they'll be interviewing applicants on Tuesday, February 25th, and on Wednesday, February 26th. And then we'll be making a decision the evening of February 26th.
by law that the vacancy must be filled within 30 days of vacancy. So I know that I personally have received some inquiries from individuals, and I'm sure other members of the board have as well. Each of us will have those conversations with folks. I do want to make sure that any members of the community who are interested will have kind of equal access to both answers, as well as be treated in the same fashion, so that when we actually do the interviews, everyone is more or less on equal footing. Are there any thoughts regarding individuals at the board about how to ensure that we're treating everyone fairly and equally as we respond to questions?
I have a question.
Yes.
Which is what someone asked me, and I, you know, I kind of have my own thought about it, but I don't know what the board's feeling is. Why are there three board members at the Q&A?
By law, we can just have, as you know, three board members. Otherwise, it needs to be a posted Board of Education meeting if we have a quorum of the board president.
Well, I think that's if it's for deliberation or discussion or taking action. So maybe we can look into that, because I think actually we've had situations where multiple board members have been there. Whitmore Lake comes to mind. I think all board members were there, and some people were leading the discussion. There was a question I had the answer to, and I walked down the microphone, gave the answer, walked back up. And so when you talk about equal access, I think maybe that means equal access to board member answers as well. So I would like to be there. I think I'm allowed to. Maybe you can look into that and see if that's a possibility. I had a personal one that evening, and I canceled it so that it didn't, like, I don't know if you want to go to two on one evening. I would, probably. So, but I wonder if we could look into that and make sure, because I think that may be a misunderstanding of the open meeting.
I think because this is, in fact, an issue that the board will be voting on, so it's important that we know that.
Well, we're not voting on the answers to people's questions, are we? Let's look it up. I'm putting that out there. I don't, I think I have the answer, and I think that you could have more, and it sounds like you have a different opinion, so let's find out. That'd be great.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Any other comments? Next item on our agenda is the, actually, I'm seeing that our board notes in the agenda, I think, is slightly reversed. On the agenda that I have before me, it would be the reproductive health curriculum. So now is an opportunity for board members to ask any questions that they might have.
Mr. Teddy, so. One more time. So this would be a class offered in a semester, part of the health curriculum. Currently, it'll be a section within the current health curriculum offering.
At yes, seventh you're grade? Within the health class at Mill Creek, okay, okay. And the health and wellness class at the
high school. Okay, refresh my memory, is that something you need to take either as a seventh grader or an eighth grader, or as a seventh grader and an eighth grader?
It's just seventh grade. It's one of four.
Okay.
Used to be focused. What is it now?
Enrichment
classes. Okay. Is that seventh grader's take throughout the year.
Okay, then if I recall, in the high school, you have one health section, is that correct? One semester of health?
It's one
that
semester.
Would be part of that.
The current graduation requirement is one credit.
Yep.
Health is a half of credit.
And it would be part of that existing class offering?
Correct.
I see. Okay. Thank you. I heard all that.
It might be a dumb question. Maybe it's already been answered. Maybe Ron just asked it. I don't know. But what I'm wondering is, I hear the reproductive health curriculum, and then there's health class, and then I thought Dr. Timmons said something about, no, it's the curriculum. So I'm wondering, are they still being taught, like, use deodorant, take a shower, clean your toenails? Is that in here, or is this a subsection of the overall health curriculum, and this is like, oh, we're going to teach us on top of that? I don't understand.
So, by law, reproductive health has to be treated separately, but it's part of the full health curriculum.
Yeah.
It's a handful of lessons overall compared to having to teach all the other things you talked about. You taught health at the high school.
Crystal's here, she can talk about
Crystal
it.
Crystal can
talk about it. Yeah, it's about 3 weeks of our curriculum. So we have about 9 weeks for health for seventh grade. Three of them are usually reproductive health.
That's what I thought, but then when Dr. Kenna said it's a curriculum, I thought, oh wait, because those kids, sometimes smell not that great. So we get the whole thing.
Yeah.
You can only provide them the information.
Anyone else with questions?
Would this take place, would this start next year? The 2021?
Yes.
Okay.
Depends on the vote,
but yes,
mostly.
Okay. This upcoming
September, you're saying? Okay.
Carol or Nick?
No, I think that what the results of the community forums are, and they go in process, and it's important for me to understand the process.
I appreciate the process. I think the survey was very useful. All the information you have here tonight is interesting.
I have a couple of questions. I looked at the units that the lesson plan and the curriculum seemed to focus primarily on one birth control method. Can other birth control methods be taught?
It focuses mainly on condoms because that's the contraceptive measure phase that helps, is most effective in helping to prevent the spread of STDs. It does address other birth control methods, yes. The STD goes through that, yes, but it focuses more on that because it's more effective.
And also, so the high school curriculum, kind of to piggyback on a question previously asked, even though it says 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th, it would actually all be taught in the health class that students take at either 9th, 10th, 11th, or 12th, whenever they fit it into their schedule. Is that correct?
Correct, which is one of the challenges of the class and how it is structured now is that you have freshmen at one end, guess seniors at the other, is obviously different spots developmentally, and that affects the depth of discussion you can get into, but it's mixed grades, yes.
Is there a preferred grade level for that material? I know as a parent of children, I never received that information in terms of, you know, we recommended it for 9th graders or 10th or whatever, but if you can't fit it in then, you can take it another year. Is there any recommendation?
Well, my preference is that there was two different health classes for freshman and an upper level. There's not really a preferred, I guess, grade for it. Unfortunately, what we're seeing is more and more kids who don't take it at all because they have personal curriculums. That's based on the rest of their schedule. And something's got to give, and oftentimes it's health. So I had that smoking committee case. We had a statistic when we presented before. Last year's graduating class, it was 25% of the graduating seniors received a personal curriculum and did not take health and wellness. So unfortunately, because we're seeing more and more kids who aren't getting this in school, again, it's not to replace what parents are doing at home, it's to supplement that, it's all mixed students, it's grade levels, fitting in when they can.
If you have a language and a music or a vocal, it's extremely hard to do that.
And then one last question. As a former neglect abuse caseworker, I know that there are children who've been sexually assaulted at young ages. The curriculum that we reviewed
is for grades 7 through 12. Is there any, I know we have a curriculum in place for grades K-6, and those topics, kind of safety and boundaries and how to reach out to an adult when needed, is taught in our K-6 curriculum. Is there a plan to review the K-6 curriculum as well?
Yes, that's part of the committee's responsibilities to review all curriculum periodically. And we've done that as kind of on a rotating basis as throughout the years. As it, so yes, that will be, all curriculum guides will be reviewed at some point as in the next. It's an ongoing process. Typically, we focus on a grade level as every year, as, and then we reevaluate the curriculum and go from there.
And Sarah was just saying something about how the safety for the younger
I
grades.
Think this building was just updated, wasn't it?
In the last couple of years, we talked about it.
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, I didn't catch that.
Safety lessons is in this building, Creekside, was updated in the last couple of years.
Thank you.
I have a comment, and then maybe it's a small question at the end. I wanted to say that I know we've heard some people this evening say that they didn't feel like the information got out. I feel like you've actually done a really good job getting the information out. At the last meeting, I pointed out that the board members had gotten the PowerPoint, but the community didn't have it. Could it be attached? I think it was that evening, maybe the next morning. I didn't check the next morning, but you know, it was put out there so people could see it. I was able to refer to it when I spoke to people. And what I feel like is people get angry when they don't know what's going on, and they don't trust the system, and they don't trust the people they're sending their kids to school as, you know, as their teachers or administrators. And so I really appreciated the email that Dr. Tim has sent. I was gonna pull it up and read some of it, but we've all read it. But it was just sort of, here's what we're doing, here's why, here's a link, or, you know, here's where you can find the entire curriculum. Here's the, even, I did actually look up the company who was, you know, to check the links out. I'm a link checker, it's just something I do. And so I read about that and I appreciated the information. And then I also say, you know, we respect your beliefs. If there's an opt-out, here's how it works, here's how to do it. And so I feel like we've really paired the notification and the opt-out properly in this situation. There's no, like, you know, big uproar. It's just, there are things to teach, there are kids who need it, and there are families that may choose to opt out, you know, ordinary, here's how you're gonna do that. And so, anyway, I just wanted to thank you for the way that you rolled this out. And then my question is, practical, I'm a practical person. If kids opt out, what do you do with them? Do you already have them dropping out? Is there a plan in place?
In my class right now, they do a project that's about health, some other health-related topic that they kind of come up with an idea, and then we, you know, work through it, and they're out of the classroom for that time. I've had kids that have, their parents have actually gone through some of the curriculum outside of the classroom with them, where parents have asked me for that, and they go through parts of it. But other than that, I don't really know what else happens if they're not in my class, so.
Any other questions from the board? Next item on the agenda is the Mill Creek Interior Design Course Proposal. Anybody sign up to send in there?
Hi, I'm Jill Jasper. I'm a 7th grade teacher at Mill Creek Middle School. I did send a presentation that I used with parents when I did the elective proposal. So she has access to that if you guys would like to send it over as well. I also took notes on my cell phone just to kind of make sure I didn't things, so sorry that I'm referring to my phone. But tonight I am seeking board approval for an interior design elective at Mill Creek Middle School. This will be a 9-week course during our 6th or 7th hour at Mill Creek. And we already have a wealth of electives that are available to students, so my hope is that this is just another one to add on the list to give students options and choice in their school day.
Students will cover not only design elements and design principles, but they will go through and facilitate projects. So they'll create different authentic projects, like not only designing for their own personal space, but also maybe developing things for our current school, like maybe developing a mindfulness space at Mill Creek. So hoping that we have some authentic projects in this class. Through this, students are going to learn different communication skills, so learning how to work with a client, learning how to work with a budget, developing floor plans and using digital ways, and also paper and pencil to use scale drawings. But not only that, presentation skills. So going over some things that we already teach in our core classes, like PV lights, which is poise, voice, light, eye contact, gestures, and speed. So going over all of those things and focusing it while they're going through their different projects. So.
Questions, comments from board members?
Yeah, great idea. Someone who yelled
bring in some HGTV to Mill Creek.
Quite often, I think this is a great idea. Get them started.
Other comments?
I thought it looks like a course that many of our students would enjoy taking. So thank you for bringing it forward.
Thank you.
So that will come back.
It's a side comment. I'll make it quick, but as long as we have some Mill Creek representatives here, I had a parent ask me about possibly having an executive function, elective, and I said, what's an executive function? I don't know. And so she sent me a link right away, and she explained, oh, it's things like, just practically speaking, are you organizing yourself? Are you keeping on track? And although I can't think of a kid who would need that, maybe some of yours, I think that there are some kids who really, really can use that. And so, I don't know, I just wanted to throw it out there as an idea. It sounds like, I don't know that they'd like break down the door to get into it, but maybe some kids could really use that.
So the Mill Creek Interior Design Course proposal will come back to the board at the next meeting. Thank you. Last item on our discussion items is an update on the legislative relations network. Quarterly, the Washington Association for School Boards has a legislative relations network coffee where local legislators representing Washington are invited along with school board members and superintendents. It's an opportunity for dialogue among all parties regarding proposed legislation so that our legislators know the impact of schools and schools can better inform and dialogue with our legislators. So I wanted to just share you some highlights of that meeting that took place on January 27th. One was an update on the January revenue contract estimate. Several times throughout the year, the state provides an update on expected revenues coming in through the state compared to what was estimated. The school aid fund is expected to take in just a slight bit more revenue, the general fund slightly less, but given the overall size of those budgets, it's fairly negligible, even though the increase is in the millions, because the budget is in the billions, it's a relatively small difference in that direction. Regarding the budget for next year that school districts might be able to anticipate, the belief is that because 2020 is an election year, that they believe that the budget will be done on time, meaning hopefully in May or early June at the very latest, so that House members can be in their districts and campaign. So there'd be an extra motivation for them to get that budget completed. They thought there might be an increase for rural districts since many House members will be campaigning in rural areas. And I know I saw since then that the governor has actually released her proposed budget. But as we know, it's the governor releases her proposed budget, the House will have their proposed, the Senate their proposed, and then they have to reconcile all of those. So we'll have to stay tuned.
There was discussion about business tax credits. The state has lost $13 billion in revenue annually to the general fund since the Engler administration due to tax credits. And just recently, there was a tax credit approved for Switch that passed by one vote. And so whenever there's a tax credit given out, that less revenue available for schools or any other functions of government.
That's fine. People only take into account what they can measure and project the losses. All of those have given out, at least with the theory, that you're going to have increased revenue, and I don't think that's ever addressed. I don't think it's really accurate to say that we've lost $13 billion. I don't know what the right numbers are, but that's all one side.
And then there were some supplemental appropriations that were done in December. There was approval for Reconnect for Community Colleges, Going Pro, which is a training program for adults, and then also Pure Michigan. So there was money put back in for those items. On pending legislation, there was discussion about the third grade retention law. This is the first year that would go into effect. There are provisions for both parents and districts to not retain students. The belief is that while there is interest on the part of some folks to repeal that third grade retention law, the House Education Chair and the Senate Education Chair strongly support the third grade retention bill. So the belief is that will stay in place as it is. There are some proposed changes to high school graduation requirements. Three of the changes are we are considering eliminating the PE and health requirement, eliminating the one credit for visual performing and applied arts, and eliminating the two credits for world languages, and eliminating the Algebra 2 requirement. And there will be a meeting this week, February 13th, on Thursday at 6:30 p.m. at the ISD office. I imagine it might be open to anyone, but it was intended for school board members. There'll be representative from Michigan Association of School Board there. And if you are interested, Susan Basquette, who is a member of the Ann Arbor School Board, has asked if you would RSVP, and I do have that email address if anyone is interested. Then there was an update on Launch Michigan. Adam Zemke, who's a former state representative in Ann Arbor, is leading Launch Michigan. It really is focused on funding for school districts. It came out of the work of the research collaborative, the school finance research collaborative. If I have those, I'm not sure if I have each of those words in correct order, but that was done and that looked at how much does it take to educate each of our children. And so Launch Michigan is promoting a funding formula based on student needs to drive equity in funding and using data to provide interventions for chronically failing schools. And I think that's it. Any questions? Okay. Now we'll go to a bond update.
We're wrapping up Bates' work. We're working on bills. We're wrapping up. We have doors at Jenkins to do. Trying to get some carpet done. And we're working on a bid for painting. Got an RFP for that. And just loose ends. We have lockers still to put in at high school that are actually somewhere. They're done now. We did it on Dexter again. And Sharon, am I missing anything? Just a bunch of loose ends. Oh, we have a ton of furniture. Yeah, we'll do another round in the summer, so We have about 70 classrooms with furniture to do this summer. Along with, we're working on bids for flexible spaces at Wiley, Mill Creek, the new, it'll be a boardroom slash training room across the street. And we have about 100 and something thousand worth of the other furniture that's being purchased spread around all over the district.
And we have principals and discretionary money. Then we did a pilot debrief, and from that pilot debrief, from the teachers who had piloted the classrooms, were allowing them to make their classrooms perfect now that they all discussed their pilots and they see what they would have really wanted. So we're doing a lot of moving around of that and giving them what they consider to be their perfect classroom.
And then that will give us the actual models to have the teachers from the buildings choose for the other 70 classrooms. I want to thank Sharon. She spent a ton of time with us. It's been a full pickup.
The hard part's getting rid of the furniture.
Well, nobody wants old furniture.
No, we're going to do it.
You do a bit like that, aren't you? Throw it away. I have stuff in my classes that have been rejected by the Ann Arbor schools. That's what I was using my name.
We have some desks. We're fortunate to find a couple districts that wanted to finally buy these desks. We have a few of these old flip-top ones that were in this building that it actually cost, was it like $6 or $8 for the flip-top? We're able to sell them for $1. We can't fix them.
No, five. Those we sold for $5.
We sold for $5, so we can't fix them cheaper than
we can sell them for. No, the whole desks. They wanted our desks, and they're taking their desks and using them as parts. And they're going to use all our desks, and when we house more classrooms, they're going to take those. And our old high school desks went to some district in Southwest Michigan, whose high school colors were burgundy. And so they loved the burgundy desks that we repurposed. They came with a semi, and they're going to take the rest of them and redo them. So their high school hadn't had new furniture since the 70s. So they were really happy to get them. We've repurposed. Nothing's gone in the landfill yet. So.
But it's shared in our office. We're spending a ton of money. There's some buildings and grounds that things get there and move us up.
Now we come to our second public participation. This is an opportunity for community members who wish to speak on any topic or one of the topics that we touched on in tonight's meeting. It's limited to 15 minutes, and there's a 3-minute individual time limit. So if more than 5 individuals wish to speak, then we'll divide the time accordingly. Is there anyone that would like to speak at this point? Seeing no hands, we'll now move on to board comments. Are there any board members?
Would like to speak. It was, I think it was so important to hear everybody who spoke tonight, but I think especially from the two Mill Creek parents who spoke about their children experience in racial bullying. And something struck me in the earlier part of the public hearing that we want to make sure that all of our kids need to feel safe if they want to learn and grow. And I think that that should be something that we strive for as a district. And I think a lot of us have seen, you know, what is happening in Saline and sort of tisk tisk. And I don't know what bubble you live in, but we experience, this is happening everywhere. It happens in Ann Arbor, it happens in Dexter. I know several kids that my kids are friends with that, you know, have had racial slurs thrown at them. And it's horrible, and it is something that I would really like to roll up our sleeves and, you know, put those words into action. And I think that that should be something that we focus on. We focus on mental health, and I cannot think that kids that have to endure any sort of bullying on any plane at all, that weighs on your mental health. And I think that that is something that we need to put in there and really, I mean, we have two parents who were here that are ready to go into it, and you know, I think that we can call upon them and several others. And I think that is really important, and I so proud of them for speaking up and making it an issue that is known. And I'm proud of Jamie for, you know, being such a leader in that.
Kind of along that line, I think for at least a couple of decades, and my memory's not real good on time, but I've always felt that this district has had an extremely high priority of kids accepting each other, of anti-bullying. So I don't think this is something new. I think we maybe need to take a step back. We maybe need to take a look and see, are there more things that we can do, which I'm sure there are. Is there some different way of focusing? But I hate to have people think that this is something that we haven't addressed, because when I've been involved with the kids, I know that there's no way they're all perfect. But like when I went to seventh grade camp, the group of kids I had in the cabin, we had a kid with autism, we had a kid with physical disabilities, and our group, the kids in the group took these kids under their wing. And so I've seen so many examples of where we have had a positive impact on how kids treat each other. And we've got a tough challenge, because if kids are causing problems in schools, they probably didn't learn in schools, they probably learned outside of the schools. And so, like many things, we do the best we can, but we don't have complete control. And there isn't any silver bullet on this. We just keep working every way as hard as we can to try and get kids to, every kid should respect every other kid. No, I don't think there's any question about that. And I don't think we even heard anything different on that tonight. But it's not something that's new. It's an effort that we haven't been making continually. So it's fine to go back and re-examine and see what we can do to make certain strides forward.
I really appreciated the comment. I think Mom made as well, but which her son said, if I don't say something, who will? And I think that's something that we can all really take to heart. That different people have different talent, different skills. You know, I don't mind speaking up. There are other people, so I also appreciated the idea of giving kids skills and strategies. Maybe they're not one to stand up and shout it out, but they need to have something they can do to make a difference. Talk to Ms. Bronson or whoever it might be. And then the second thing I wanted, I know Julie will bring us reports from the legislative breakfast, which we appreciate hearing. I was able to go to the hearing where they talked about changing the start of school. And I know Dexter's not going to do that, so nobody needs to be scared or freak out. But there were some interesting things that were said there. And one of the ideas is that schools that start earlier have more time to prepare for the AP test. So I'm not saying that we should start August 1st, but a school that starts August, I'm not saying that, but a school that starts August 1st is going to have a whole extra month of class where they get to, you know, an AP is a lot of memorizing and learning and strategizing, then you have your projects to build and in the, you know, some of the other classes. So one of the superintendents felt like that was one of the reasons to maybe start. He's just thinking a week. The other really interesting thing I heard, and this is a little mind-bending, but is that they, even though we don't, the semester doesn't end until mid-January, some high school students here, they can say anything about this, they go ahead and have finals before Christmas, and then they do projects after Christmas. And the benefit there is, well, you've done your finals before Christmas. He said it's so quiet in the halls a few days. Everybody's studying, working on their finals. You're done. Teachers still don't have to grade the stuff until the end of the semester, so it's not like they're working all through Christmas or holiday break on the, you know, the finals the kids took. And then you have this great project time where it's like, oh, they're just happy. They have their break. They're going to work on these projects together. There's all this love in the building. And so even when they shift to a week earlier, which this is a school that's going to petition, or I think they're going to take advantage of starting a week earlier, just based on the enthusiasm of the superintendent, he says they're still going to have a week after
they're still not going to end until a weekend of January, and that they're so they're just going to do projects then, but they're going to have an extra week of the semester to do their work. So I know it's just kind of like, wow, that's so different. Would we ever do anything different? I don't know, but that's a thought. So I just wanted to share that with you. And my personal question, which I asked at the meeting, is when do kids learn best, right? We're educators, we're about education. I know that Michigan wants to like start after Labor Day and get everybody to go spend their money. And then there are other reasons for families where you might want to shift it one way or another. If you have a kid in high school, you're going to get an extra week of vacation having school start sooner because they have to be back mid-August anyway, it doesn't matter. But on the other hand, with your little kids, maybe you have different plans. You want to just enjoy the end of summer and, you know, have your kids have a great time. So I'm really not promoting one or the other. I asked my sample of one, who will still be in high school, and he says he couldn't care less. So, you know. And then the last thing I wanted to bring up is just more of something kind of for the board. And I wonder if now would be a good time to reevaluate the committee assignments and acknowledge that reducing my responsibilities on the board may not be the best choice for the board or for what the people who voted for me had in mind, which is to have my influence minimized. So I hadn't really thought about that, but it didn't matter too much from a committee. I'm going to enjoy being on committees, but someone came to one of my chats and said that they felt like, you know, committees are where people have their influence, and when you're not on a committee, you really do have less influence. And she didn't feel very good about that. And so then I realized, I guess that's true. I've been attending them and listening, so I don't get behind and know what's going on. But I would like to participate again. And I feel like being off of the committees is not collegiate or properly organizational for what the board policies intend. We have a new leadership here tonight. And I'm going to say Michael was not wrong when he said I'm the hardest working board member, and I'd like to get back to work. Thank you. That's just my comment.
Any other comments? And Annalisa, I want to apologize. I need to remember to look left. So I know we discussed the reproductive health curriculum, and I should have asked if you had input, but now is an appropriate time if you have any comment.
Well, I'm supportive of the new curriculum, and I definitely do think that's lacking. But they were talking about the personal curriculum. I am a student with a personal curriculum, so I never took health in high school because I am an IB diploma student and I didn't have the time. But I think it is important, and I think the new curriculum is productive. I don't know if there was a way around a personal curriculum where we could still take health, but I don't know how I could have done that. But
I have a couple comments. One is I wanted to recognize Trish McNamer, who was named Field Hockey Coach of the Year for the state, so kudos to her. Also, I had the opportunity to see the high school musical Fiddler on the Roof. And it is wonderful. If you haven't seen it, I encourage you to go this coming weekend. It's one of my all-time favorite musicals, but the students did a wonderful job. And I think one of the kids was in there. I'm not sure which one, but and well, I wasn't sure which role, because you know they have a whole group playing the and then lastly, I just want to thank the Beacon and the Anchor Elementary students for these wonderful signs. And did you say it was Wiley involved as well? And Wiley, yeah. Yeah. So thank you very much. They're always, I adore anything created by the kids, so thank you very much. Any other comments? Okay. There's no information items, there's no closed session, so the meeting is adjourned. Thank you, everyone.
No, actually, I don't need to be a moment of course.